was at the Winnipeg Folk Festival last summer, this past summer, and I was on the shuttle bus, and I was sitting next to John Hammond. And I was like, oh, across the aisle. And I said, oh, you know, I saw you years ago, and I'm from Ottawa. And he goes, Harvey Glatt.
Certainly almost anything from any arts discipline that moves in Ottawa, Harvey has had some hand in supporting it.
And his love of folk music is sometimes hidden by some of the things that he's done. You'd think that he's more of an entrepreneur, but Harvey Glatt is a true folkie at heart.
If I had a hammer, I'd hammer in the morning.
He's the first guy to bring in Pete Seeger into Ottawa back in the late 50s.
And I've seen him at FMO conferences, Folk Alliance conferences, and he's, you know, I mean, the guy's an octogenarian now, but he bops around to all the showcase rooms. And my cell phone, you know, a message comes up, come to room 604, there's this act you gotta see.
I think it was because of the love of the music and the intellectual qualities of that folk music. To bring people music of life, you know, how folk music touches. I think he did it because he loved it.
It's not only the passion for music, but I'm a person who obsessively, compulsively wants to share what I like with other people. I was a child of radio. There was no television in those days. And around the age of 12, I noticed a publication on the music stands called Billboard. I used to buy that every week and really learn about what was going on in the music business. At college, it was Clarkson College in Potsdam, New York. From the first year, I got involved in being a DJ on the radio station, having a regular music program. And I became the sports director, and I broadcast hockey.
There's a pass to Porter. Porter coming in all alone. He gets ready. He shoots. A great save by Bone. It's shot by Meeker. He scores.
I was very impressed by a store in New York City called Sam Goody's. And they had a wide range of music. You would have a classical department, a jazz department, a pop department, and in each department there would be somebody who really knew the music. There was nothing like that in Ottawa. I had a partner in those days. His name was Arnold Gossowich. We each got our parents to lend us $5,000 and we started a store.
And they carried everything. They were like Sam the record man. You could get everything.
I got a job at Treble Clef, his record store chain. He'd feel out all the employees about what their tastes were, and, you know, and Harvey pretty encouraging. Like, one of the employees was really into Celtic music. So he sort of let him develop this entire Celtic section. As the chieftains came into the store, and Paddy Maloney was like, he looked at this Celtic section that was in there and said, that's the best Celtic music selection I've seen outside of Ireland.
In 1960, a few University of Ottawa students had a club upstairs on Rideau Street. Their landlord said they had to get out. So they came to me and said, Harvey, can you help us find a new location? So we found a location on Bank Street, and so I became a one-third partner with two other people, Denis Faulkner and George Gordon Lennox, and we started to do stuff.
And there's the famous story of Harvey introducing Graham Nash to Joni Mitchell at the Hebrew Coffee House.
And then Harvey started bringing in these folk singers in the club, in the theater, and then he'd bring in groups like Jimi Hendrix.
All of this eventually led to doing Bob Dylan at the Auditorium, the Rolling Stones in 1964, Beach Boys in partnership with Richard Flohill, did Miles Davis at Massey Hall, did Simon and Garfunkel at Massey Hall, took Paul Simon over to see Gordon Lightfoot perform at the Riverboat after the concert.
In 65, we had a group called The Children with Bill Hawkins and Bruce Colburn and several of us, and it was a very good little group, and Harvey kind of bankrolled that thing until we sort of went bust.
Bruce's original manager, I think his only other manager before me, was Harvey.
Yeah, and I worked at Treble Clef Records for a couple of years, and that's when, up till 77, when he started Shea 106, Shea FM, in Ottawa, which was an independently owned FM radio station.
We learned a lot from the CBC, not just from other commercial radio stations. And we learned from what CHOM had been doing in Montreal. We learned from what CHOM FM had been doing. So we were playing quite a wide diversity of music, blues and jazz and folk.
And Harvey is an anomaly amongst radio programmers or radio station owners insofar as we weren't playing enough unknown material, which is usually the opposite. Play more hits kind of thing. And Harvey was like, and he was in my office all the time with magazine clippings and albums and cassettes of artists that he'd been turned on to or he'd discovered. It was definitely the opposite of any other program director or station manager owner that you'd ever encounter.
So he understood how kind of tough radio could be on Canadian records. So even with the Canadian content regulations, all too often, and it's still true today, I'm afraid, people interpret the minimum as a maximum.
What I've seen about Harvey is his work behind the scenes that people don't know about. How he supports so many artists. And I mean hard support.
One of the biggest commitments that we made, and I joke about it being partly self-interest, is putting in a new assistive hearing device system in the three main halls of the National Arts Center. The system is for people who just have bad hearing, people who have hearing aids, that there's a way of transmitting the sound to the hearing aids, but also even for people who have cochlear implants, the devices can plug into that. And we remember one night when there was the official launch, and it was a musical concert with a concerto, when there was a woman who was using her cochlear implant. She was in tears saying, I've never really heard anything like this.
Most of the time in my life, I can't just talk about Harvey. I got to talk about Louise. Most concerts, there'd be a follow-up party. And there'd be all us kids, you know, all us guys who were just teenagers, who were in the folk thing, who hadn't seen a break too much, go over and meet these guys. Oh!
So their house was always full of music and instruments and stuff. I mean, you go into the Harvey's den and there'd be like two grand pianos in case Ferranti and Teicher ever showed up. And there'd be a Hammond B3 organ in the corner and a set of drums over there, guitars. So, you know, jam sessions were not uncommon either. So.
Seriously, as far as my love and my heart and soul is music, it would have shaken out some way, but I don't think it could have been in any better hands than Harvey Glatt.
So Harvey, congratulations on the Estelle Klein Award. I know that you knew Estelle, as I did, and I know that she would be thrilled to know that you're getting the award, as I am, and as I'm sure everybody is. So congratulations, well deserved.
Closes and the rainbow runs away. I will bring you incense owls by night, by candlelight, by jewelry, if only you will stay. Pretty baby, won't you wake up, it's a Chelsea morning.